dobry. And congratulations on being here on Friday. I am impressed with your focus, your attention, and your interest. So first of all, let's find out who we are. How many of you here have heard about mind maps? Excellent. How many of you have made mind maps? Good. How many of you still make mind maps? Good, and thank you for being honest, because many of you have used one and now haven't used one. So obviously in some areas they didn't work for you. So we'll check that out and why. How many of you are scientists? How many of you are not scientists? Okay, so nearly 100%. How many of you are poets? None. How many of you are not poets? Wonderful. How many of you are artists? 7 of you. 7. How many of you are not artists? Not. Okay. How many of you daydream? Aha. So that's nearly 100% of you. In school and university, daydreaming in the class, is that considered good or bad? Bad. Bad. So we know that this group, 300-ish people, no poets, no artists, one. So 99.333% of not poets, not poets, not artists, not scientists, and you're all bad. Because you all daydream. So we're already in trouble, right? How many of you daydream every day? So that's all of you. How many of you enjoy your daydream? All of you. How many of you have had a daydream in this lecture hall while I've been with you? One, which means that also in this hall, 299 are liars. Because I know you did daydream. So it's very important. How many of you are studying psychology or sociology, anthropology? Okay. So we're going to do what is known as metacognition, thinking about thinking. And I would like you to think about who you are and why you're here. What are you doing here? And you're going to graduate. When you graduate, you will have to talk, you'll have to teach, you'll have to explain things to people. So I want you to put yourself in an imaginary situation. You're a graduate. You have your degree. You're in an audience of 2,000 people, and there are 3 or 4 lecturers giving a half an hour lecture, each one a half an hour lecture. And you are in the audience. Unfortunately, one of the speakers gets stuck at the airport and can't make it. And the master of ceremonies knows that you are a graduate in the creative university. And so they come up to you and say, look, I've got a problem. I've got a half an hour slot and the lecture is not coming. And I've got 2,000 people. Will you please fill in the spot? Talk for half an hour. And you can talk about anything you like, anything you studied at the university, your thesis, your graduation, things you're really interested in. So I want you now to imagine that you are that person and you need to give the master of ceremonies your curriculum vitae, your resume, and you can give it in any language because you imagine that the master of ceremonies speaks 100 languages. So you can give it in any language. I'd like you to summarize you, and give it to the master of ceremonies, who will then introduce you as Roman did me, and then you speak. All right, team? On your marks, get set, go. Give you 4 or 5 minutes to summarize who you are and think about it. Who am I? Starting now. Use paper. They need paper. No paper. All right, team. I would like you now to introduce yourself to your partner from your notes, just say, this is me, and explain who you are. Starting now, give yourself 2 minutes to exchange. One more minute.
whiteboard.
Thank you.
Do you need to flip chart the paper or?
No, that's fine.
It's fine.
Okay, team. So we are now going to metacognate. We're going to metacognate. And when you're thinking about thinking, you have to find the correct formula. You have to know what to do and how to do it. And there is a common global expression called practice makes what? How many of you have heard practice makes perfect? How many of you agree with that, that practice makes perfect? So you all agree. You need to think about it. Because practice does make perfect. So if you practice bad thinking, you become a perfect bad thinker. How exciting. So let's now check how you do think. How many of you, when you introduced yourself, used mind map? How many of you used a mind map? Okay, so a number of you. There was not one mind map there. I scanned you. And there was not a mind map. So those of you who did a mind map didn't. So when you are practicing mind maps badly, you become perfect at bad mind mapping. So let's explore it more. How many of you love color? How many of you love colors? Okay, keep your hands up. Look around. Okay, everybody does. Which is interesting because none of you are artists, except one. How many of you used two or more colors in your note? Three of you. How many of you used one color? Ta-da! And it was you who did it. You chose one color. Now you'll be pleased to know that when I was a student, I hated studying. I did not like it. I did not like homework. I did not like having lots of tests and exams. Frightening. How many of you, when you were in school, and even in some areas of university, how many of you did not like studying and doing lots of homework and note-taking? Keep your hands up. Look around. Right? Basically unanimous. So why? Why did Tony Buzan not like it? And why didn't all the leading thinking students at this university? Why not? So let's investigate it. In your notes, if you use one color, what color do you think in universities and schools in Poland and around the world, what is the number one and two colors in note-taking? Black and blue. And number three is gray. Now, I know you're not scientists, but in science, the science of perception, the brain receives waves, waves of light, waves of sound, and deals with them. And color is a chroma, a color. So one color is a mono, one chroma, one color. In terms of physics, that is a monotonus, one tone of color, monotonus. When you combine mono and tonus, what word do you get? Monotone, monotonous. If something is really, really monotonous, what is the word around the world that is used to describe something really, really, hello again, monotonous? And you all knew it. Every one of you are boring. And you're all different. But your brain works on the same principles. Boring. So now explore, now metacognate. When you are bored, what does your brain do when you are really bored? Daydream. What else? Tunes out. Switches off. Shuts down. Goes to sleep. Go around the world to university libraries. University libraries. And look at people studying. What are half of them often doing? Sleeping. Sleeping. Public bedroom. Around the world, the university and school libraries. And when your brain does tune out, does switch off, does shut down, it is very, very intelligent because it's wasting its time. It's turning itself off. So what's the point? Which is why you didn't like it and why I didn't like it. So color changes your brain. Color turns you on, switches you on, wakes you up. Color does. And most of you carrying one color. So think about it. Why? Why not? I personally carry these with me. How many of you have read Harry Potter? Ta-da! Harry Potter has power to control. How does he do that? With what? With a wand. With a wand. Now you imagine that I had a wand and I could go poom and I'd raise your IQ by 20 points. And then I could go poof and your memory would be better. And I could go bang, bang. And your creativity, your innovation, up. Oomph. Your brain and your body suddenly integrated. How many of you would be happy to have a higher IQ, a better memory, better creativity, better integration of the brain and the body? Wonderful. This is the wand. Color does all of it and does it incredibly well. Biologically, when your brain is looking at colors, and playing with colors, you wake up hundreds of millions of brain cells. They wake up. So you can think of the brain with its million workers called the neurons, and you've got them. And in the morning you wake up and you got, let's say, 300 million color connected brain cells. And you say to them, yeah, fine, I'm just going to use one color. And so 300 million say, thanks, boss. We'll just stay in bed. And they do. So I want you to discuss with your colleagues, what are the advantages of color when you use multiple colors in your notes, in your mind map? What do the colors help you do better? And discuss it in groups of four or five. Deep conversation. What do they do? Starting now. You can take wherever you like. You can go here, you can follow me, you can anywhere. She she can take photographs wherever she wants, as many as possible, and really creative. One more minute. Our team is very well dressed. Let's see you again. Okay, team. So let me rattle them off and make a note of what color does. Memory. Memory improves recall. And it strengthens short-term memory, medium-term memory, and long-term memory. Color triggers creative thinking. Color physically, biologically stimulates your occipital lobe. Your occipital lobe, the vision, the back of your head. And color also stimulates the connections with other brain cells around the world. Color reduces stress. How many of you in university feel overloaded, information overloaded, stressful? How many of you feel stress? All of you. And you are training, you're practicing perfectly how to be stressed. And you're doing really well. You will get more and more and more stressed. And you'll graduate. And you'll start to work. And you'll practice how to think badly. And in your job, you will become more and more perfect at colorless thinking. You will be colorless. A colorless personality. And you will become perfectly colorless. And do think about that, because it's another way of describing how to make yourself blind. And you are practicing it. So colors help you invigorate your vision. All of you love colors. So when you use colors, you are using a tool which you love. You love it. And when you love something, all of your learning rises. When you love somebody, how is your focus? It's total, isn't it? If you don't love them, you know, they're just kind of colorless people. You don't even know who they are. You never remember them. So when you use color, you fall in love with your own brain and its self-expression. So this is serious. You know, color is not, color, what a waste of time. It's serious stuff. It's life and death. And you have to make the decisions. And dare one say it, that when you use color, you will have fun. Fun. So you'll no longer be a serious student with a face that looks like stone. You'll be smiling, you'll be happy, you'll have fun learning. When you have fun, is it better to have fun or to be serious? Fun. Fun. So whenever you're with me, if I see a room of stone face, how unpleasant. How unhappy for me. When you're laughing, smiling, when you're telling jokes, you're using your colorful personality. So please use colors for the rest of your life and carry them around with you. They are on all levels. They are a wand. They improve all those things. And all you got to do is use them. Less effort than what you have been doing. It makes your life easier as well. So very important for your brain to know what it's doing, to metacognate. You have introduced yourselves, so I'm going to introduce myself. And I'm going to introduce you to two things. One is me, and two is the mind map. What is far more important than me is the mind map. So I'm going to build a mind map of me, and I'm going to say nothing. I'm just going to give you a mind map. And I want you to be like a detective. You got to work out what is a mind map. Some of you who did a mind map and you didn't, check it. I say, oh yeah, I didn't. So you will learn how to use your brain really well. Are you ready? And follow this and work out what a mind map is and why it works. And already you can see that there is a formula, isn't there? It always works in that way, with those deep laws behind it. And every mind map follows that kind of structure, but the subject is always different. That's me, but far more importantly, that is a mind map. The basic laws. And mind maps say image in the center, because an image, a picture is worth what? A picture is worth 1,000 words. So when you take note after note after note after note, you waste your time. Images, colors, images everywhere. The branches, are the branches straight or curved? Curved. Because your thinking is natural, it's organic. It's like trees, flowers, organic. The main branches, have big keywords. This could be you. So you could have you in the middle, and the main branches wouldn't be my branches, but you could have your branch family. Another branch could be interests. Another branch could be my goal, my vision in life. Another branch could be your physical activity. Another big branch could be my friends. Another branch, my enemies. Another branch, my biggest mistakes so far in my life. How many of you have made some big mistakes? Wonderful. Wonderful. When you make mistakes, you do what? Learn from them. So I want you now to do it again, i.e., introduce yourself and do it intelligently. Use your amazing intelligence to say, this is me. And you are now already in your life. You're getting ready to graduate. You will be asked in universities, in schools, in companies, in governments, to say who you are. And if you just send them a normal curriculum vitae, it'll be put in the stack and they'll forget. But if you put a really good mind map, you will in all probability at least get a good interview. So 5 minutes, do a good mind map on who you are, starting now. You have to use them very, very gently because the nibs are for fine. Yeah, choose five. And check your thinking habits, you know, because you and I have been trained to think words. So we put our name in black. So don't put your name there in the middle. Put an image of you, a picture of you, or an image if you are you're a mountaineer. Put a picture of a mountain. Little stick figure climbing up. That's me. And do these fast, because this is like brainstorming. But when you're brainstorming fast, you can still do it beautifully. You can still use color. You can still sketch in quick little image. Consider this to be a draft, like a first draft, as a good artist always does. Well done, team. They're starting well. And if your neighbor is doing it well, do what with them? Copy. Copy. Copy the good. It doesn't mean you have to put their words in it, but their style, the way they use color, the beautiful branches, the strong, big key words, incorporate their style in yours. Excellent. Good start. You're now using the mind map to mine your mind. You are excavating. That's a very good mind map. I know. Notice, when you look at the mind map, there are no boxes in it. Even in softwares, there are boxes. Not recommended. Boxes are like little prisons that your thoughts are trapped in. So don't use boxes. And note that the key words, this one key word, not phrases and sentences, key words. keywords and make sure that the connections are close, strong. One of the common expressions is think out of the box. And when you use boxes, you have mental blocks. You have thinking blocks. You have writing blocks. I will keep a note of your name. Okay, team. I want you now, in your same pairs of two, to introduce yourself again and at the same time have your first one next to it and look at what you did in 1 hour ago and what you have just done. And in this second exercise, you had less time. You had less time to do it. So exchange and have both in front of you so you can compare in 1 hour how you can transform your thinking. Starting now. And introduce yourself with enthusiasm. This is me, Brahm.
What's going on with this cable?
Probably not.
Pardon?
Probably not.
Probably not. Maybe, maybe one or two? No?
If it's a good question. Two. One more minute. Okay, team. So a couple of questions. When you did the mind map, did it feel the same as when you were introducing yourself the first time? I'll try that again. When you did the mind map, did it feel different from when you were doing the first linear one color? Did it feel different? How many of you enjoyed doing the mind map? Wonderful. Because it's natural. So what could you now use the mind map for? Everything. Everything. You can use it for brainstorming, you can use it for noting. For example, let's imagine that you are studying psychology. So in the middle, you put a picture of a brain or you put the psychology symbol, and then you have main branches. What main branches will you have in psychology? Experimental. Child, theories, figures, i.e. people, like Lujanov from Moskva, like B.F. Skinner from Harvard, Pavlov again from Moskva, and on and on. So your mind map, you can prepare an essay, a thesis, and it takes you no time at all. Tony always uses mind maps. All the books that I have written, the 140 books, in fact, and I'm writing one here, when I'm writing them, always mind maps, because it's so easy. Just map it out, like the map of a city, and then you go and travel around that city, and you know where to go. So I'm going to give you one or two more pieces of information to help you use your brain. As I told you, in the library, in the university, I was told when I wanted that operations manual, I said, you know, need a book on my brain. There is no book. The medical section is over there. So I had to learn how to use my brain, which is why I rejected some of my professors, because they weren't teaching me anything. I kept some professors because they were really good. So I chose, and outside the university, I contacted other professors, leaders, thinkers, revolutionaries, and checked in with them. So one of the ones I want you to connect with is Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo da Vinci. How many of you have studied Leonardo? If you haven't, do. Leonardo has used all his multiple intelligences. Get his notebooks. Don't read what people said about Leonardo. They will say what they think. But look at what he says. And he said many things, but one of the things he said was the following. And please note, he said, I am a student. I am a student of nature. So he did not say, I am an artist. He said, I'm a student of nature. And he loved nature. How many of you love nature? Everybody. Which is the way the brain is. So you love nature. And Leonardo not only loved it, he was her student. He learnt from nature. And he said, people look and they don't see. They listen and they don't hear. They eat and they don't taste. They touch and they don't feel. And they talk and they don't think, said Leonardo. So he said, I am a student of nature. Next, I observe her. And her is mother, big capital H. So I am a student of nature. I observe her. I then analyze her. So I study and analyze her. And then I copy her. He said, copying is your main channel into all learning and all thinking. So I want you to follow Leonardo. Be a student of nature, observe her, study her, analyze her, copy her. So on your big sheet of paper, I want you to draw, although you're not artists, I want you to draw a butterfly. And you can draw a butterfly, you can copy, you've got to copy, so you can copy that butterfly from your brain, your imagination, or you can copy a butterfly from the internet. You can, you know, check, find some butterflies. Oh, I like that one. Copy that one, but copy it. Copy it well. There are some butterflies here. If your neighbor is doing a really good butterfly, copy her or him. Okay, team? So as non-artists, I want you simply to be a student of nature. Copy her. And make sure you analyze. Don't just sloppy. Study it. Analyze it. And then copy it. And copy it, as I said, from your imagination, your library of visual memory. Copy from it. And do your butterfly on its own page. Don't find a little corner in your note with your one color note. Do your butterfly on a page. Don't try to save paper. Try to save your brain. Yes, good. Butterfly. Now. Good, you're starting well. And copy it. Make sure you have studied it. You've analyzed it. And do look around and see what your neighbors are doing. And if you think, wow, I like that one, copy them. Copy the best. I am pleased to see that some of you have finished a little butterfly and you've done another one and another one. So some of you have already done three butterflies as artists. There are some beautiful butterflies emerging. Very good. I'm going to curry each time. Your magic wand. Give yourself one more minute. You don't have to finish it. Just go as far as you can with it. And do copy. All right, team, How many of you have looked around and seen some really good butterflies? Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up. Look around. 100%. Which means that other people were looking at your butterfly saying, yeah, pretty good. This was your first butterfly. And it was good. And you were simply following what Leonardo said. Every human brain is naturally an artist when it knows the correct formula. So when you practice what Leonardo said, you become a magnificent artist because your brain is designed to do it. So I want you to show the camera how brilliant you are. So hold them up. You, the artist. Keep them up. Keep them up because he's scanning. He's zooming in, broom, on some of your butterflies. And when you're keeping it up, kind of look around and see the other butterflies. But make sure that yours is still up. Keep them up so the camera and your professor is going to. All right, team. Yes? So now, how many of you are now an artist? An artist. So when you're an artist and you mind map, most people, when they learn the mind map, know that they can't draw. So they start doing a mind map and say, I can't do that. Images, yeah, I'm not an artist. But now you know you can. So in your mind maps, you can practice and practice drawing, sketching, doodling, coloring in, and you will get better and better and better. And your mind map will get better and better and better. And that's an hour, 1 hour and a bit. And you've already changed your mind. Boom, you've switched it to where you need to go. And you need to keep going on the journey of improving your metacognition and the use of your multiple intelligences. And I'm going to be back here, so I expect to see you being even more brilliant. I will be back on September 13th in Warsaw, 13 September, teaching in the Butterfly Project 50,000 students. The Butterfly Project needs more help. So make sure that you commit to go to the National Stadium, where 50,000 students are, and those students need you. So when they're drawing the butterfly, when they're trying to do the mind map, they'll make all the same mistakes as you did. So when you go, bring your mind maps. Say, look, I can help you. Look at my butterfly, bang. To inspire them, because that's the main goal, isn't it? To help every student that you ever meet, to help them to no longer starve mentally You feed them good mind and brain food. All right, team, a couple of questions, and then I shall wish you well and farewell.
Proszę Państwa, czy są jakieś pytania? Już podchodzę z mikrofonem.
Hello?
Okay, so no questions?
No, there is a question here.
Oh.
Hello. It's really nice to meet you. I learned about mind maps years ago when I was studying, and I used it then a lot to make notes, and it helped me a lot in some exams. Now I'm more interested in things like homeschooling, and I wanted to ask you if you have worked or presented, or do you know about the results of this tool in different environment than a formal education, or for children who are deprived of education, or who just choose to stay at home?
I know a lot about homeschooling. How many of you are going to become a teacher? Okay, a few of you. How many of you are going to become a parent? Okay, so nearly all of you. How many of you already have children? Right, a lot of you. Teachers and parents are thought of as different. The number one teacher in the world is the parent. So you're going to be a teacher anyway. And teaching is the number one profession because it nurtures the brain. And around the world, more and more parents of children are realizing that their children are in a school where their brain is being starved. They're like being a butterfly, which is why the project starts with an egg. It then grows into a caterpillar. It then becomes a cocoon, and then it becomes a butterfly. Think of it as a child. Many children start as a little egg, squash, finished. Some of them who survive become a caterpillar, and they are fed junk food. Junk physical food, junk brain food, caterpillar. And even though it's unhealthy, they just say, ah, squash. Another child, gone. Still alive, but mentally dying. Some get to a cocoon. Cocoon, when it's in a bad environment, when the caterpillar has been fed badly, it turns into dust. A few make it, and they become a butterfly. Some of them, however, come out and they are deformed because they were not fed well. So the Butterfly Project says we must teach children wonderfully and realize that they are potentially genius when they are looked after and nurtured well. So homeschooling is why a growing number of parents around the world are saying, I'm taking my child out of school because I want them to survive. And they bring friends and they say, you know, how many of you have studied chemistry? Oh, yeah, I liked chemistry. Okay. How many of you have done sport? Yeah, I'm a, you know, so, yeah. And they bring a little team. And they bring their child and the other children, and they form homeschooling. It's a very good idea when there is a school that is not teaching them properly. So it's a matter of choice, but is one of the growing industries around the world. It's a growing industry. Home schooling. It's an encouraging sign. Okay, one more question.
Hello. Professor, I'd like to ask one question. Is it as effective to create a mind map through some sort of software on PC as it is to create a mind map through a sheet of paper?
Very good question. I mean, that's an important question. Software or the hand? What do you think? First, the hand. Your hand and arm are like a giant pipe of incredibly complex wires that go vroom into the brain. This is a memory tool. It is kinesthetic. It uses rhythm. It uses all your cortical skills. This does. So when you draw the mind map, this instrument memorizes the entire thing, the whole thing. When you're doing a software one, if you're digitalizing it, dig, 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 you don't remember. You remember, dig, 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 dig. So the more you use your body, the better. On the other side, the software, particularly the iMindMap software, the iMindMap, this one, you can do things with the software that you cannot do with your hand. So I do use both. And when I have a mind map, and I think, I'd like to give that to 1 million people. Pumpf. It goes to 1 million people. Or I think, it'd be really nice to add about 15 things here. And there's no room. So on the software, I go, pumpf. Child mind map. So that branch becomes a mind map. If I think, be nice to change the colors of the branches. Yeah, okay. Pump. And they all change. Or I think, this branch here, I'd like to have up there. And the branch changes. So what is the answer? Use the hand or the computer? Both. Always both. And if you want to test yourself, you want to examine yourself, it's a really good idea. Because with the software, it can be I take off all the information. I'm taking it off on my screen. And that's the mind map on Tony Buzan. And it's disappearing. Now my hand-drawn mind map, I can't rub that out. But I can. Take it off. So I could now examine you. On that page, what was the first main branch? What else was on that branch? What was the main branch down here? Media. Was there a sportsman branch? Where was that? So the mind map is a memory tool, and with the software you can examine yourself. You got your mind map of biology, or your mind map of psychology, or a mind map of an experiment by Pavlov and all the information. And you do it by hand, then you transfer it, and you can test yourself. So both. And the mind map becomes like a friend of yours. It's a companion. You carry the mind map with you, both physically, in your computer, and in your brain. All right, team. When I come back, I hope to have already had contact with you, because I was told about 5 years ago, Twitter is a good idea. And I said, I don't think so. You know, you read Twitter and it says, this afternoon at 3:25, I went to the toilet. Yeah. Not interesting. But then I thought, Twitter can be like a mind map. So if the central image is the brain, mind mapping, then I can put that on. Only 140 characters, so like a small poem. So a good tweet is like a small poem. And then, if you link to me, and my home Twitter number is @Tony_Buzan. When you tweet with a really brilliant thought or a fabulous mind map, I will retweet you. And when you go onto that Twitter, you will not hear my favorite football team is. I brush my teeth at 4 o'clock every morning. It'll be, here is a mind map from a student in Mexico. Here is a mind map from a 6-year-old child from Japan. Here is some information from the brain research about. So I will look forward to meeting you for the rest of my life. Be brilliant, because I know you are. Enjoy your butterflies. Please do support the Butterfly Project. And this brochure was designed by volunteers. But all of them were mind mappers. And they use color. And indeed, you're here. That's where we are. They knew where we were going to meet. Examples of mind maps. Beautiful butterflies. Good images, which you can use in your exams, your thesis, your Twitter, your social networking. Already one example of an entire school in Karachi with poor teachers teaching all these kids mind mapping and butterflies. And the kids fell in love with their school, which is what every school should be. We have these right there. We have these, so I will end by wishing you well. Use your brain well, and we'll give you a brochure of the Butterfly Project, and I want to see you in the stadium, 13 September, with your and this university's support.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.